Hello and welcome to Super Team. Today we have Brandon, who's the co-founder and CEO of the Phantom Wallet. And I'm incredibly excited to have him because this is probably my favorite Web3 product today. And I think, Tanmay, yours as well.
Same. I'm very excited. I'm sure you recognize it, but Phantom is going to be, it's going to be the first Web3 experience for millions of people. And we are I have personally got 20 of my friends onto Phantom, especially because, you know, my first Web3 experience was, you know, MetaMask and, you know, Ethereum. And then I came onto Solana and I started using Phantom and I was like, holy shit. It's like discovering this, you know, massive delta from there and being like, this is so cool. And then convincing everybody. So I think this is going to be that for many more people. How's growth been for you? Have you seen this with many more people? What's that been like?
I'd say definitely anecdotally, I've been hearing about a lot of things similar to that. A lot of sort of like super fans, who have been sort of like advocating for Phantom, but also like definitely been hearing about a lot of people where Phantom and Solana is sort of like their first crypto experience. And yeah, it's just been like really awesome to see.
Well, the compliment stopped there because my next question is when mobile?
we're working on it right now. Obviously, we know that it's a hotly anticipated thing and a lot of people
get that right.
We definitely want to get it right, and I think we put a lot of care and attention to detail into the product, and not only the product but the whole experience around the product, communication, education, etc. And so we just want to make sure that we're sort of like carrying through that sort of ethos with the mobile app.
What do you mean by wanting to get it right on mobile? Like, what do you have to keep in mind when you have to get a wallet right on mobile? You know, are you looking at other wallets on mobile and thinking you want to do something different than what they've done?
Yeah, it's more, it's sort of like sort of the philosophy that we took when we were sort of building the extension. We basically just want to make sure that the end product is like very stable, very polished, basically like continues to bring that sort of like mind-blowing, like first-time experience.
I'm curious to know about two things. One, a little bit more about your background. Now that we conveyed our deep passion for a product that we use. We want to know where that came from, where you come from. And second, how your company is organized, because you kind of look feel like a tech company from the outside, but you're operating in a Web3-like environment. And so do you operate like a standard Silicon Valley startup, or have you incorporated some things from the Web3 world that have helped you along the way?
So yeah, I think my story probably resonates with like quite a few people out there who are like sort of working in big tech or like traditional jobs, looking at crypto today and thinking about like whether it's the right time to jump in or not. My first encounters with crypto was in 2017 during sort of like the last major like big hype cycle with ICOs and all of that. Basically for 4 years prior to that, I was working at Twitter. After working there for a while, basically became quite disillusioned with like the typical work loop, which involved like a lot of politics, bureaucracy, A/B testing at that scale and whatnot. But yeah, eventually I decided that I wanted to break into a nascent industry, and eventually found myself happening upon Ethereum, which really blew my mind at that time, because it was sort of like I came from this consumer technology world, and it's sort of like this entirely new way to even think about what consumer applications are. But yeah, eventually, you know, found myself sort of like reading white papers more than just doing normal work. Basically found my way to a then nascent startup called ZeroX, which builds decentralized exchange technology on Ethereum. Spent my time there building a number of like pretty widely used like dApps or like Web 3.0 apps on Ethereum. My co-founders and I all met at ZeroX, basically all became power users of MetaMask, not only from a consumer perspective, but also from a developer perspective. And yeah, we sort of like, we all realized how powerful a wallet was in the ecosystem, and realized that a wallet was in this really awesome spot where it could really like kind of unlock, just kind of like 10x the entire space if we got it right. So yeah, we decided to like basically like throw our hat into the ring and enter the wallet arena, so to speak.
And because you come from a Web 2 background, do you have any advice for anybody thinking who's on the edge of their seat right now, going like, I don't like A/B testing everything, because you know how tech companies are like, I don't want to A/B test if like 7 is greater than 6, before launching a product?
Well, I'd say Web 2.0, Web 3.0, there's a lot of commonalities and a lot of overlap. I'd say, like, you know, a lot of skill sets that you learn. It's just like a lot more nascent, a lot more like Wild West, a lot more experimentation and stuff like that. And so I'd say, like, my number one like advice, which is like, definitely just keep an open mind. Like throughout my time in crypto, I feel like a lot of times I was probably should have been a bit more open-minded about different things, and never know what's going to like blow up or become the next big thing. Don't be afraid, just like sort of like come at it with like an open mindset.
You worked on a lot of Ethereum-based technology, right? Tell us about your encounter with Solana. What was that first time like? And what made you choose saying, okay, I want to build a wallet for Solana?
So yeah, I guess like taking a step back. So when we were working at ZeroX, we had an insight where we realized that there was this like multi-chain world coming where the demand for blockchain networks and blockchain computing was growing and growing, and basically the supply was not able to keep up. And so concretely what that meant was like fees on Ethereum were becoming like extremely high. We knew that a lot of companies like ZeroX and like other adjacent companies like Compound, Uniswap, et cetera, were all sort of exploring, thinking about how they would maneuver in this like multi-chain world. So we knew that this was coming. And we basically wanted to start our journey by placing a bet on like a nascent ecosystem. You know, there's a number of like different ecosystems that are all sort of like touting very similar value props, like cheaper, faster, et cetera. So that set included Solana, like Near, Polkadot, Cosmos, et cetera. And we sort of like, you know, laid all those options out on a table and just did a lot of research around where to basically like place our bet. And I think there was a lot of things that Solana had going for it that like really like stood out to me as like a big winner. And so yeah, there's like the table stakes stuff, like it's faster and cheaper. But then there's other things like adjacency to like large players like FTX, Circle, who they produce USDC, was very bullish on Solana as well. At that time, the second largest deployment of USDC was on Solana outside of Ethereum. And we knew coming from like a DeFi background that basically stable coins are the lifeblood of like all financial activity on these blockchains. And then, one other thing is that there was definitely one major downside of Solana that a lot of people like to reference is that it's not EVM compatible, or it's not easy to like take existing like Ethereum smart contracts and like port them over to Solana. And a lot of people would actually tout that as like a negative. In my mind, like what actually happened because of that is like it actually fostered like a more genuine core of like development around Solana. The EVM compatibility actually like promotes like more of like a drive-by copy and paste type technology and projects instead of like some stuff that was like more, I guess, like homebrewed or homegrown. So all those things combined, we're like, okay, this seems like a good bet. So we're like, place the bet, and yeah, now we're here.
Yeah, with Solana, it's like if you're able to make it through learning Rust and somehow all your limbs are together by the end of it, it's like the welcoming to the cult, right? Like there's proof of work before you even get into development. We saw that with the hackathon in India as well, right? Like it promoted some sort of bonding experience between all the developers. Like, hey, we made it. You said multi-chain world, right? Which means that Phantom would also be multi-chain. Like, can you talk a little bit about that vision of yours and maybe peek a little bit in the future about coming plans for Phantom?
Medium to long-term vision of Phantom is basically becoming a user's passport to using blockchain-based applications. So no matter where or how that application is implemented, whether it's like on Ethereum or Solana or whatever, the ultimate goal should be someone wants to use like a DeFi application or NFT application or what have you, their first instinct should be to like reach for Phantom and use Phantom as their tool to do that. And so that's, you know, that's where I think the world is going, and that's where we want to go as well. That being said, though, at this moment, we're very much focused on Solana specifically, and an effort not to divide our focus too much. We're really really doubling down on Solana at the moment.
I think the vision for Phantom is probably useful to explain, Brandon, for those who may not be aware of why wallets are so central and key. So for example, one of the frames I have on this is VCs, when they saw crypto, they said, this is too much like entropy. We have no idea what's going on here. The best way to make a bet in the space is to invest in an exchange. So I would actually argue that the best way for VCs to have invested or still do is actually to have invested in a wallet because a wallet is Web3 native, where an exchange is just a centralized marketplace where you're trading crypto assets back and forth. And the margins for an exchange are a race to the bottom, because ultimately DEXs and all other competitive products will ensure that it's kind of trivial to exchange one asset for another. And so the actual moat or the interesting investment could have been for wallets. A, do you agree with that? And B, can you explain why wallets are central?
You know, definitely agree that I think wallets are a great investment to make and are going to be like a huge...
It would be weird for him to disagree. I don't know about wallets.
No, I think wallets will be huge. Like, perhaps one reason why they haven't been as popular before is like people had not figured out what types of blockchain applications people want to use. I think DeFi is like just sort of like hit its like main growth spurt in 2020, just last year. And then like since then we've had NFTs, just like sort of like an order of magnitude. One analogy that I like to use for why wallets are so important. So you can basically think of like how successful blockchain ecosystem is by thinking about it as like a two-sided marketplace. So there's like supply side and there's a demand side. Supply side is like applications and developers. So those are things that are sort of like live on the blockchain, and the demand side is actually end consumers. And those consumers actually come to these ecosystems to use the applications. And the more that those two sides kind of like grow in tandem, like the stronger the network effect of that blockchain ecosystem becomes. Because more users means more opportunity for developers and applications there are, like it attracts more users. The cool thing about wallets is like the wallets are actually where those two parties like actually meet. And so end consumers download wallets. Wallets help those consumers get access to applications. If we do our job the best that we can actually foster both of those sides and then like spur like huge growth in like the underlying ecosystem. Yeah, I think people are figuring out like you have like an awesome wallet, like your ecosystem has a lot better chance to like grow underneath. So
I think if people want to understand why wallets are so central and why we're kind of like, you know, obsessively talking about wallets all this while, here's an experience I would recommend. Pick up the phone and call a friend. This is what I did to Tanmay. And I said, hey, Tanmay, can you download Phantom Wallet? Tanmay did. He set it up in like 30 seconds. And I said, all right, look, I'm now going to send you one US dollar, okay? I'm going to send you one USDC. I'll press send right now. As soon as I said that I was going to press send, I did press send. And he's like, hey, it's already here. And then you've said 1,000 words without saying anything.
Yeah, now this magical experience, right? Akshay, you keep talking about, dude, there's wrapped Bitcoin. There's wrapped Ethereum on this. Like, now imagine the possibilities. It's like these rails have been built for, you know, instant money transfer across the globe.
So yeah, the technology underneath Solana like makes this experience possible. It's really sort of like...
Oh, sorry. Didn't mean to compliment you, Brandon.
Yeah. No problem. Just making sure everyone knows.
We have a wish list of product features we'd like. Okay. So this interview is just an excuse, Brandon, to get to talk to you. Okay. So I'm going to ask you a few of them. Okay. And then I want to know what's on the product roadmap that you can share. Hopefully you can share more than what's already public. Okay. So when multi-chain?
Originally, we were sort of talking about having some sort of beta or something out by this year, maybe more realistically first half of next year, just given sort of like our all hands on deck sort of like situation right now.
Is someone watching over you? Is someone standing there?
No.
Saying, don't reveal too much.
No, I'm actually I'm actually in the Solana office right now in San Francisco, and
That's probably good to look around then.
There are just some people walking around.
Got it.
Okay. When social recovery, and just for folks listening, social recovery is, you know, you've got to, if you have a wallet, you're self-custodying your assets, you've got to remember a passphrase. Social recovery makes it so that, like, let's say you divide up your key into five parts and then you give them to your friends. And if you ever were to lose your phone or whatever, you can recover that by having 3 out of 5 of those friends sign a message so you can get back your wallet.
So yes, key management in general is definitely sort of like a product surface of the wallet that we definitely want to push the envelope in. Right now, basically this year for us has like been a lot about like building out like the base of the wallet and building out like a complete feature set, what people expect from like the feature set of a wallet or MetaMask, etc. We know that in order to like really bring that next like cohort of users over, it is going to require some more, I think, friendly key management solutions, one of which can be something like social recovery. Second, first half of next year, we'll also introduce some sort of like more advanced like key management that helps people, yeah, to sort of like manage their keys better.
So do you want to talk about the product features that are coming up that you haven't discussed publicly, or maybe you have, you know, people want to still know?
In this next release, still focusing on like user protection features. One big problem still right now is like a lot of like phishing sites that look similar to another domain of like a popular app. So like Dgen Apes, but like where the G is a J or something like that. So we're going to be putting together sort of a solution for that, which involves sort of like a community owned repository of like malicious sites where someone who encounters one can sort of like very quickly flag it and then propagate it to the rest of like the users. Internationalization is something that I actually haven't spoken too much about, but that's also going to be coming in the next release, and we'll have support for a lot of different languages.
Got it. Are you hiring? Because we have a lot of folks in our community who are good at, of course, writing code. They're awesome, very talented developers, but also people who are great community managers and things like this. So are you hiring?
We are looking for a lot of engineers specifically at the moment, I guess more specifically like front end client engineers, mobile, web. Yeah, and also going to be looking to like build out sort of like more of like the business development and growth function as well, like early next year.
Got it. Yeah, we'll link to the open roles in the description so people who are interested can go check it out and apply.
So one of your investors is Gary Tan, right? I want to know what your experience with him is, given his experience with design and how Phantom is known for its design. Can you tell me a little bit about that relationship?
We actually don't interact like super a lot, but he has helped in a couple of different ways so far. So like, for example, like closing candidates. He's been awesome. It's like sending a candidate like a nice, like a personalized video from Gary Tan. Like, you know, that's like one way to close someone. And so he's actually helped us do like stuff like that before, helped us make a couple connections in the past. Most of our investors sort of help us for like sort of like little one-off connections and stuff like that.
Akshay, do you want to talk about role of VC in Web3?
I was just going to ask you, Brandon, you're also at the interesting intersection of, you're kind of a company, but you're also in Web3. What is most valuable to you as a VC today? For a VC adding value to you as a founder today?
Yeah, you know, our lead investor was Andreessen Horowitz, and they actually have been really awesome. And basically, like, they're sort of like a small, like kind of like an operations team in a box where they help with like sourcing candidates, making sure that we're like hiring like in a compliant way. Like, they help us like form offers, like make sure that like our offers in terms of like compensation are like in line with the market. They even help us like interview candidates as well for people operations manager or like HR or something like that. They'll basically like actually get in there and like help us interview, making connections that are like mutually beneficial. I think that's at our stage, that's what's been the most helpful for us.
We're learning how to do some of this. So it's been an interesting experience, right? Because, you know, even when, as Solana builds out, the way we're thinking about like supporting Solana projects is a kind of like portfolio services, like you described, right? Like anybody building on the Solana platform should be able to get this, you know, we describe it in three ways, as three things really: private distribution, public distribution, operational excellence, right? So private distribution is BD, sales, reaching privately a certain customer or certain stakeholder. Public distribution is kind of media and marketing and communications and things like this. And then on the operational excellence side, it's just the Web2 discipline and focus that comes with operational excellence. Right, and bringing that over, because I really think that is valuable, especially in crypto, because there's so much going on. There's something new every day. There's a new idea every day, and a lot of people in crypto actually succumb to that. Right, they end up working on four or five things at the same time, and I guess it's common in new industries or whatever. But that's probably not going to succeed in the long run.
Ben, can we talk a few numbers? What's the last update, public update that you did of the number of users on Phantom?
Yeah, so yesterday, we tweeted out that we hit 700,000 downloads. And so according to the Chrome Store, we have like 700,000 weekly actives. And yeah, we basically have been like gaining like 100,000 new users per week. And so yeah, every time we tweet something out, it's like out of date by like the next week.
In the time it took to tweet this out, we've added 100,000 new users.
Yeah, it's been really crazy.
So Tanmay, I want us to show Brandon the potential of India. Let's just riff on this a little bit, okay? So, Brandon, we have an idea, okay?
Okay.
We have a community of folks who are passionate about Web3, and you know, there are a lot of developers, a lot of like really crypto native people. So one idea we were thinking of was, if to introduce people to Phantom, I think it's best done in a Web3 style. And Web3 is peer-to-peer, as opposed to, you know, like the centralized company marketing to its customers. You know, the best products get adopted peer-to-peer. One of the ideas we have is, let's say we come up with a goal, okay, a project, let's call it Project 100K, where we get you 100,000 users from India. And the way we would do it is, we would find a way where a crypto native person can onboard a non-crypto native person, like a newbie. That's the format, okay? Here's what we would want to do.
I think we want to marry Phantom with the other sexiest aspect of crypto, which is NFTs, right? Like Phantom has this beautiful section where your collectibles or NFTs can be seen. And the way we want to position it is, imagine if the NFT collection is called Web3 Visa, right? Like, this NFT is certification that you are Web3 ready. What that means is, you know how to download Phantom, you know how to install it, you know how to go to a website, connect your wallet, and mint an NFT. The level of dopamine hits you get once you combine NFTs and Phantom is like that's a conversion to Web3. And we want to make a sexy website where it's a beautiful Web3 Visa, shiny Visa that we design. And it's for free. We don't charge anything, because the idea is, let's just get people two beautiful dopamine hits and get them addicted to this world. I think the way we were thinking of doing it was making this website and gatekeeping our Discord by saying that, hey, you can enter the Super Team Discord. If you go here, download Phantom, get your Visa, and then log into our Discord server using this Visa. That's the way to access us. And every time we do an event in the Discord, we say, hey, get your Visa and come attend an event or whatever, you know, that we're doing on the Discord. What do you think of this idea?
Yeah, I mean, sounds awesome. I love sort of like the educational aspect of it, like helps people onboard, like gives them those dopamine hits. And like, not only that, but you have like this extra sort of like community gating aspect exactly. to it as well. So it really sort of starts to create that like mental model for people. So it sounds awesome. Definitely down to like participate with you guys.
We're also going to leave all the open roles at Phantom that you guys can check out. Guys, it's a beautiful application. You know, I don't mind people telling me, stop shilling Phantom. I'm okay with shilling Phantom. I really
Yeah, we're
like
not investors or anything, unfortunately.
Yeah,
Brandon,
yeah, unfortunately.
Like, we're not even getting paid for this, just to be clear. We can fix that, Brandon, you know. Send us the email.
You guys should go check Phantom out. Brandon, thank you so much for taking time out, man.
Thank you, Brandon.
Yeah, totally.
It's a pleasure having you.
Yeah, no, thanks, sir. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. And the next time we talk, we want to be at 5 billion users, all right? Which is, so I guess next week. We'll chat next week.
All right. Challenge accepted.
Thanks, Brandon.